Sir, your guest has come.
Let him in.
So, you're from the Middle West? I thought men like you was born and raised on Wall Street. You know, wife of one of my best friend in Detroit came from your city. I was an usher at a wedding. Judy Sims or Judy Jones. She was once.
Yes, I knew her.
Awfully nice girl. I'm sort of sorry for her.
Why?
Looks he has gone to pieces in a way. I don't mean he uses her, but he drinks and runs around.
Doesn't she run around?
No, stay at home with her kids.
Oh.
She's a little too old for him.
Too old? Why, man? She's only 27.
Oh, I guess you're busy. I didn't realize.
No, I'm not busy. I'm not busy at all. Did you say she was 27? No, I said she was 27.
Yes, you did.
Go on then. Go on. About Judy Jones.
I'm not trying to start a row. She's a nice girl and I like her. I can't understand how a man like Luke Sim could fall madly in love with her like that way. He treat her like the devil. Oh, they not going to get divorced or anything. When he's particularly outrageous, she forgive him. Oh, in fact, I'm inclined to think she loves him. She was a pretty girl when she first came to Detroit.
Isn't she a pretty girl anymore?
Oh, she's alright. A lot of women just fade like that. You must have seen it happen. I forgot how pretty she was at her wedding. I have seen her so much since then. She has nice eyes.
Yes, nice eyes. Really. In the fall, when the days become crisp and gray, the long Minnesota winter shuts down like a wide lid of the box. At these times, the country gives me a feeling of profound melancholy, so often me the lane should lie and enforce its followers, haunted by grass buried for the long season. October filled me with hope, with November raised to a source of hysteria of triumph, and in its mood, the fleeting brilliant expressions of the summer sherry islands was ready to kiss my mouth. Some of the caddies were poor as sin and live in one-room houses with an rustingly cow in the front yard. My father owned the second-best grocery store near the Black Bear. The best one was the Hub, patronized by the wealthy people from the Sherry Islands, and I carried all for pocket money.
Morning, darling. How's it going?
Good, Mom. Nice day, Mom, Dad. Bye, Mom. Fool make me clench my hands and tremble and repeat idiotic sentences to myself and make brisk afro gesture of command to imaginary audiences and armies. In my imagination, I always desired to become a golf champion and defeat Mr. D.A. Hendrick in a marvelous match. Perhaps I win all what laughable is, or maybe it is a comic magnificently from behind. One day, I was stepping from a Pierce Arrow automobile Let me spend more time with George, surrounded by an admiring crowd among those who watch me and the open-mouthed wonder is him. Sir, I don't want to carry anymore. Too old.
You were not more than 14. Why the devil did you decide just this morning that you wanted to quit? You promised. This week, you go over to the state tournament with me.
I decided I was too old.
Sugar and smoke rings. I've been a fool for strawberries and cigarettes. Always taste like you. Headlights on me, racing through 60. I've been a fool for strawberries and cigarettes. Always taste like
you. Well, it's definitely a nice day, Hilda.
Well, I guess there are not very many people out here this morning, are there? And I don't know what we're supposed to do now.
Huh, that's alright. I'll fix it up.
Boy, do you know where the gold teacher is?
He's giving a lesson.
Well, so do you know where the KD master is?
He isn't here yet this morning.
We'd like to get a KD. Mrs. John sent us out to play golf, and we don't know how without we get a KD.
There aren't any KDs here except me. I gotta stay here in charge until the KD master gets here.
See, I told you not to do that, but you never listened to me. You damn little mean old thing.
What's the matter, lady?
Miss John is to have a little kitty, and this one say he can't go.
Mr. McKenna said I was to wait here till you came.
Well, he's here now.
What are you standing there like a dummy for? Go pick up the young lady's gloves.
I don't think I'll go out today.
You don't?
Go!
I think I'll quit. The enormity of my decision frightened me. I was a favorite caddy, and the $30 a month I earned for a summer would not make elsewhere around the lake. But I received a strong emotional shock, and my perturbation requires a violent and immediate outlet. This is not so simple as that either, as so frequently with the case in the future, I was unconsciously dictated to by the grander dreams. They persuaded me several years later to pass as a business course at a state university. My father, prospering now, when I paved my way for the precarious advantage of attending an older and more family university in the East, where I was bothered by my scanty fund.
Thank you.
But yeah, the octopus scientist brings a woman off the course. It's getting to be outrageous.
Do you mind if I go through?
You hit me in the stomach.
Did I? Sorry.
Oh, where can it be?
Well, I've seen my bones, so thank you.
Who's that? Aren't you one of those men we play through this afternoon? Well, do you know how to drive a motorboat? Because if you do, I wish you drive this one so I can ride on the surfboard behind. My name is Chui Jones, and I live in a house over there on the island, and in that house, there is a man waiting for me. When he drove up at the door, I drove out of the dock, because he says I'm his ideal.
Oh, it's awful cold. What's your name?
Dexter.
Oh, why don't you come to dinner tomorrow night?
Mother and father won't be here.
During dinner, she slipped into a moody depression, which gave me a feeling of uneasiness. Whatever petulance she uttered in her frothy voice worried me. Whatever she smiled at me, at the chicken liver, at nothing, it disturbed me that her smile could have no root in mirth, or even in amusement.
Do you mind if I weep a little?
I'm afraid I'm boring you.
Oh, I don't know what happened to me. Last night, I thought I was in love with a man. But tonight, I think I'm in love with you.
For the first time, I've asked her to marry me.
Well, maybe someday. Kiss me. I'd like to marry you. I love you.
When I saw that there was a new man tonight, I had been hardened against jealousy long before. That was in October, when I was 25. In January, I and Irene became engaged. It was to be now in June, and we were to be married 3 months later. Irene!
Dexter, Irene's gone upstairs with a splitting headache. She wanted to go with you, but I made her go to bed.
Yes, nothing serious.
Oh no, she's going to play golf with you in the morning. Now you can spare her for just one night, can you, Dexter?
Alright, ma'am. Good night.
I ain't got time for you, baby. Either you're mine or you're not.
Make up your mind, sweet baby. Right here, right now is all we got. A little party never killed nobody. So we gon' dance until we drop.
I returned to the university club, stood in the doorway of the room for a moment, watched as the dancers. And leaned against the doorpost. Suddenly, a familiar voice rising and make me stirred.
Hello, darling.
When did you get back?
Come here and I'll tell you about it. Have you missed me?
Everybody miss you.
Oh, what a remark. Admittedly, you're handsomer than you used to be. Dexter, you have the most memorable eyes to me.
Oh, I'm awfully tired of everything. I wish you married me.
I think we'd get along. Unless, probably, you've forgotten me and fallen in love with another girl. Of course, you could never love anybody but me. I like the way you love me. Oh, Dexter, have you forgotten last year?
No, I haven't forgotten.
Neither have I. I wish we could be like that again.
I don't think we can.
I suppose not. I hear that you're giving Iron Screener a violent rush.
Oh, take me home. I don't want to go back to that idiotic dance without children. I'm more beautiful than anybody else. Why can't I be happy? I'd like to marry you if you have me, Dexter. I suppose you think I'm not worth having, but I'd be so beautiful for you, Dexter.
I love her. I would love her until the days were too old for loving, but I couldn't love her. So it takes the deep pain that is reserved only for the strong, just as I taste for a little while the deep happiness. I went east in February with the intention of selling out my long trees and settling in New York. But the war came to America in March and changed my plans. I was one of the young thousand who greeted the war with a certain amount of relief, welcoming liberation from webs of tangled emotion. I have nothing else to lose. I was invulnerable at last. But I could feel I had just something more than if I had married Judy and seen her fade away before my eyes. Long ago there was something in me, but now nothing's gone. Nothing's gone. I cannot cry. I cannot care. Nothing will come back no more.